The date is easy for me to remember. Mother's Day, Sunday, May 11, 1941. I wasn't quite 9 years old, and I was one more excited youngster. That was the day the Missouri Pacific Lines inaugurated a brand new streamlined train from Memphis to Tallulah, Louisiana, via Mariana, Helena, McGee, and Lake Village. They called it the Delta Eagle. After all, we were in the heart of the rich Delta farming area. Farmers made good money with cotton and other products for many years. The railroads hauled agricultural products as well as people. I guess it was a couple of weeks earlier when my grandfather, Edwin A. Boss Hicks, prominent Phillips County planter and ginner, came home one day and called my mother into the living room. "Here, Marion Louise," he said, giving her 3 round-trip tickets. "You and your mama, Nellie Hicks, my grandmother, and the boy, get on that new train they've been talking about and enjoy its first trip to Memphis and back." At age 9, minus a couple of months, I felt like I was on my way to heaven with a round-trip ticket. The big blue and cream-colored streamliner with the silver eagle on the locomotive's nose was no stranger to the area. Missouri Pacific had been showing it off with private runs, charters, and civic and business groups, etc. But this was the first run for the general public. A Mother's Day gift from the railroad, a train official proudly said. The Eagle was not a long train, only 2 coaches plus the 1,000-horsepower diesel engine made by the Electromotive Division of General Motors Corporation. The front coach contained a U.S. Mail Railway post office section and 60 comfortable seats for African-American passengers. That was the era of segregation, but regardless of a person's color, everyone around then was excited about Helena being on the route of the nation's newest streamliner. The second coach, with 48 seats, contained a grill, complete with kitchen, 2 tables, and a counter with 3 stools. No matter where you sat on the train, someone would take your food or drink order and serve you at your seat. I was up early that Sunday, so were my mother and grandmother. The train was scheduled to leave Helena shortly before 10 a.m., put us into Memphis a little before noon. The crowd was at the classic old depot at the foot of Cherry Street, which now serves as the Delta Cultural Center, complete with a meeting room known as the Delta Eagle Room. Mother managed to find a parking place in front for our 1939 Pontiac. As we were not staying overnight, there was no luggage to fool with. Mother and grandmother sat on one of the depot benches and talked with friends they knew who were also making the trip. Little Randy went outside by the track to listen for the deep sound of the diesel's horn. I also looked at the little gas electric doodle bug parked at near the depot. It had arrived from Clarendon shortly before 9. Finally, we heard the Eagle's horn blowing as it came in from Helena Crossing, past the Helena Cotton Oil Mill, and as it neared the Arkansas Street crossing by the Economy Grocery. Lights were flashing red on the street as the switchman fixed it where he could back in the 4 or 5 blocks into the station. Then slowly we headed in that direction as our eyes watched for the rear end of the new train to come into view. One final blow of the horn as the train crossed the road leading up to the seawall and down to the Helena Ferry Landing. Finally, with hissing and air horns and cheers from the crowd, the beautiful train hummed to a halt. Doors were open and the few passengers getting off at Helena did so. Then it was our turn, stepping first on a step stool, then grabbing a handrail and making the next 2 or 3 steps into the coach. The train had a new smell to it, plus the waft of breakfast food cooked for others on the train headed north. We found seats together away from the May sunshine, and grandmother wondered how long it would be at the station. About that time, I said, "Look, Mom, we're moving." The smooth diesel eased out of the station. We could hear the horn blowing as we began to that, gathering speed, heading for Helena Crossing, where the Helena Bridge now comes into town. Continuing to pick up speed, we were soon crossing the highway where my grandfather's white camp gin was located. And in a little while, we paused at a busy railroad point known as Lexa. This is where the railroad iced a lot of their refrigerator cars from the Rio Grande Valley as that produce headed north and to the east. My Uncle Julian Tardy ran that icing operation for City Products Company out of Chicago. Next came Mariana, then Hughes. More people were out to see the train than got on it. I did not know anything about head counts at that time, but I could see the Eagle was pretty full. During the war years, Pearl Harbor was only 7 months away, there would be many times when there was standing room only on the train, even with a 3rd car added to the consist. I wanted something to eat, but Mother kept saying, "No, honey, we're going to eat when we get to Memphis." So I settled for a Coca-Cola at the price of 40 cents a bottle, plus a dime tip. Who ever heard of paying 50 cents for a Coke? The conductor stopped at our seat to visit and let me examine his ticket punch. He had been by shortly after we left town and punched our tickets, but he was too busy to stop then. Next thing we knew, the train was on a trestle as we neared the Mississippi River. As we crossed the Harahan Bridge, we could see the Memphis skyline and the muddy waters of Old Man River below us. Also, cars were on the single-lane road paralleling the train track as it crossed the ridge. Once across, we threaded our way through a maze of tracks used by the Rock Island, Illinois Central, Frisco, Nashville, Chattanooga, and St. Louis railways, as well as the Missouri Pacific and Cotton Belt. The Rock Island had its own streamliner that served Arkansas, the Choctaw Rocket, which ran daily between Memphis and Amarillo, Texas, and served Forest City and Brinkley before entering Little Rock at the famed Choctaw Station, which now houses the Clinton School of Public Service. After gliding past Roland, where I live now, it stopped at Boonville before exiting the state. I wonder what it would have been like to watch the rocket go by right down the hill from my current family home. A couple minutes before noon, the Delta Eagle backed into the Memphis Union Station. The conductor on the PA system thanked us for riding and invited us to come again. Mother, grandmother, and I quickly found a yellow cab, which took us to the Peabody Hotel for what we thought would be an elegant Sunday lunch. I don't know what kind of fancy food they had, but all Randy wanted was a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. "Surely you want something else, honey. We're at the Peabody," my mother said. "No, I don't," I replied. So they dined royally. I enjoyed my two slices of white bread spread with peanut butter and jelly, just like at home. After lunch, I looked through the lower-level window into the studio of radio station WREC, which I could pick up at home clearly. Little did I know that I had jobs in radio coming my way, first at KFFA in Helena 15 years later, and then at KTHS in Little Rock, the 50,000-watt powerhouse known now under the letters KAAY. The ladies warned the window shop that stores were not open on Sunday. Mother noted some article of clothing she liked, wrote down the description, jotted down the phone number, and a sign on the door. Around 3 p.m., we caught a cab from the Peabody back to the Union Station and made our way to the gate where the Delta Eagle was sitting. We boarded about 3:40 p.m. Many of the folks who had come up that morning decided to spend the night, so the train was less crowded on the return trip. Twilight eventually overtook us just as the glow of the street lights and car lights. Traffic was far from heavy in those days. Next thing I knew, I was sound asleep between my mother and grandmother. Been a big day in the life of a 9-year-old who hasn't lost his love for trains for more than 70 years. The swaying of the coach lulled me to sleep until I felt my mother nudge me and saying, "Honey, wake up, we're almost home." As I looked out, we were backing into the Helena Depot, and I had arrived home with a lifetime of memories.